640 Zone Sid Rosenberg Show is on the air.
640 Sports.
Jim Nantz, my dear friend Jim Nantz. He's a great golfer, Jimmy, too. You know that, right? I think he played in college with, University of Houston with, Freddie Couples. And dear friends with the Bushes, very, very close with 41-43. And Jeb, who's back on stage tonight. And, see, Jeb ain't going anywhere because he's got, you know, he's raised $13 million for his campaign, and he's got super PAC money like no one's ever seen before. So he's not going anywhere. But, you see, Jimmy did not want to talk much about Jeb Bush tonight. He's like, how about those Dolphins? Jeb needs a strong showing tonight like the Mets do. We need this one tonight. We blew that one last night. And
I need some confidence from Tim McCormick.
Armando Benitez. Timmy's going to pick the Royals. Now, Tim did work for the Mets for many years. All of us Met fans love Tim McCarver. I would imagine his loyalty is with the Mets. But the last time the Royals won a World Series, they beat the Cardinals, who he played for. But we'll find out right now. The greatest baseball man alive today. He's called more World Series games than anybody. Had a great career. Is my dear friend, Tim McCarver. Good morning, Timmy.
Hey, good morning, Sid. How you doing?
I'm well.
Jim Nantz was Fred Couples' roommate. I guess you've already covered that.
Yeah, yeah. And Jimmy, of course, he calls the Masters, but he's a really good golfer, too. I think
Oh, yeah. One of the great guys in our business, too.
Just yeah, class act.
A gentleman on every level.
Agreed, like you are. Now, how many, tell me this, Tim, how many World Series games over your career, not played in, we'll get to that, too, how many World Series games have you called on television?
I don't know the exact number. Over 100.
Oh my God!
I did 24 World Series in a row. So,
jeez.
I think Jim Nantz. Matter of fact, I know this. Jim has told me that his desire is to do 50 Masters. I think he's done like 35 or six right now.
Yeah.
He wants to do 50. I did not want to do 50 World Series.
But you did the best one of all, Tim. You did, because we've been playing the last couple of days, highlights of the 69 Mets, 73 Mets, 2000 Mets, and, of course, 86. You called that one, didn't you?
No, I did not.
What?
No, in those days that ABC and NBC were rotating.
Oh, it was Vince Scully and Jack Buck, right? It was Scully and Buck, right?
It was Scully and Joe Garagiola.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
Yeah. So that was our off year, and it did 85 and 87, but not the 86 series. As a matter of fact, I was in Nelson Doubleday, the majority owner's booth, when Boston took that 2-run lead in the 10th inning, and when the Mets flashed on the board, congratulations to the world champion Red Sox. And I saw that thing turn around in a hurry. Boy.
Now, did you do the NLCS against the Astros, though, before that?
Say that again?
Did you do the NLCS against Houston before that, or none of that?
Yes.
You did?
Yes. The 16-inning game with Keith Jackson.
Right.
And that was, I think, the most exciting game that I have ever been a part of, and that's saying something, because there were a lot of them.
I'm so glad you said that, because for as great as that Met comeback was, game six against the Red Sox in 86, that game you're talking about on so many levels. First of all, the Hatcher home run, then Strawberry wins it with a home run. Second of all, the undaunting task of trying to beat Mike Scott in a game seven was never going to happen. I could tell you this, Tim. I was at a Billy Joel concert at Madison Square Garden that night. And this is a true story. So that game went 16 innings, you know. So when it went to the ninth inning, there was an announcement inside the Madison Square Garden. The guy goes, fans. Billy Joel will not be coming out until the Met game is over. I swear to God. So they allowed us to leave Madison Square Garden, went outside, and thousands of us stood outside of Charlie O's watching the Met game. The Mets win in the most improbable, incredible fashion. We come back inside and sitting at the piano wearing a Met hat and playing New York State of Mind, Billy Joel, who, by the way, is going to sing the national anthem Friday night, game three in Queens.
Oh, you got to love that now. I mean, that's a great story. I did not know that.
Yeah, it was crazy.
That's a fabulous story. And the three runs the Mets scored in the ninth inning to tie Houston to send it to extra innings was a much more improbable inning than any of the innings that followed that. So
that's
the excitement
point.
Was really in the ninth inning.
Yeah.
Because you're right, if the Mets don't come back and win that game, that series was over. Mike Scott. Nobody was going to hit Mike Scott.
Totally agree.
Yeah, so.
He was
anyway,
great that year. He was magnificent.
Who do you think was the most valuable player in the game last night?
I would say the most. Oh, see, if you would have told me.
It's
that,
interesting, isn't it?
Yeah, because if you would have told me that Volquez found out about his dad, a very sad story, before the game and pitched like that, I would have said him. I guess last night, you got to go Gordon because he tied the game, right?
How about Ben Zobrist?
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, it's a guy. Here's one of the quirks about baseball is that if you look in the box score today for the recap of the game, you see Ben Zobrist with three hits, but you don't know the importance of the three hits. Two were leadoff doubles that led the runs. And the last one in the 14th inning, after the error, Escobar's on at first base, the single by Zobrist. So Escobar gets credit with a run scored. Posner gets credit with a run driven in. Nothing for Zobrist, but his was the most important hit of the ball game, really.
Interesting.
If you think about it, now you could say Alex Gordon, but Zobrist did it three times.
That's fair. Now, that's a very interesting point. I will say
it's a quirky game.
Yes.
I mean, it's unbelievable. Sometimes it's the guys who do the masqueraded stuff or the secret stuff that you don't really understand that he's done until after the game's over and you sit and contemplate it. That's why it's one of the great games ever.
Could not agree more. Now, Met fans, even though this has been a great season, heck, we're in the World Series, okay, and I like us tonight. So it's been magical. It's been fantastic. And listen, the Mets have been around for 50-plus years, and this is our fifth World Series opportunity. It has not been awful by any stretch. The problem is we get compared up in New York to the Yankees. But you know this, Met fans are thinking, oh, my God, last night was Armando Benitez all over again. You know that.
I don't think you can put Familia in the category of Benitez by any stretch of the imagination. I mean, nobody was saying that when he was ironing out hitters of the Chicago Cubs and blowing people away. There's no connection whatsoever to Familia. And I mean, you know, Familia is almost a guy that nobody thought would be a closer this year anyway for the Mets.
Yeah. And he's been magnificent. There's no question. This is the way they lost the game, very similar to the game one of the Yankees back in 2000. But listen, I'll say this, Tim. We know this. The Met season turned around basically the day they acquired Cespedes. And he wasn't good. He was great. He carried us for 2 months. We're only where we are now because of his heroics during the regular season. But between the Chicago series and last night, that blunder in the first inning, this guy's losing money every single day.
You're right. I mean, the acquisition of Cespedes was one of the most impactful acquisitions of any recent memory over the last 40, 50 years. And my hat's off to Sandy Alderson for making that move.
But you would agree that it has not, lately it has not gone well for Cespedes.
Yeah, but I mean, he's the biggest reason that the Mets are there.
Yes.
So, I mean, you can't start after one loss, start picking the Mets apart because it's just not fair. Even if they go four and out, if Kansas City goes four and out, it wouldn't be fair.
No, Kansas City, they're a good team.
Fairness has never had anything to do with broadcasters.
Right. So then, you're right. Listen, the Mets have had a great season, and they're built for success because we are young, assuming that Freddie will sign a lot of these kids. But staying in this series for a second, best pitcher on the Mets has been DeGrom. He has been. And he gets to start tonight. And you know this, Tim. You played in all these things. If you split the first two on the road, you've done well because we come home with three in a row Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. So with that said, is tonight a must win for the Mets?
No. No, I mean, you know, if you're a Mets fan, you'd like to see them win and go back 1-1. But I mean, they're a must-win. No, I don't think so. Going back home, but the one surprising thing to me was why Harvey started the game last night. I mean, to me, why don't you start DeGrom? Why is Harvey starting the game? Now he pitched well, three runs in what, six innings? He pitched well. Would DeGrom have done that? I think he would have bettered that, but that's just my opinion. And by starting DeGrom in game one, you have an outside chance if he has an economical games one and or starts 1-4, perhaps, that he could come back in the seventh game and start it, and if not start it, be in the bullpen and be ready to go four innings. I mean, if Madison Bumgarner did it 48 hours later last year, why couldn't DeGrom do it?
Yeah.
Well, the younger pitchers. So why? Nobody's really questioned that, and I thought it was odd that Harvey started the game to begin with.
Yeah, I mean, Matt is still a great pitcher, but you're right. DeGrom has distinguished himself as a better pitcher on the team, but there has been a report out of New York. There seems to be an ongoing back and forth between Jacob DeGrom and his skipper, Terry Collins. Collins claiming that Jacob DeGrom is fatigued, and DeGrom saying no, but the point is, if there is some concern that he is, in fact, fatigued, maybe that's why he waited an extra day. I don't know that, but that was a report coming out of New York.
Yeah, I mean, we probably will never know that. You know, maybe belated information like at the start of next season or something like that. But the point is that Jacob DeGrom is the best pitcher the Mets have. And if you're talking about going with your best, I mean, to throw the low strike with his fastball, with the consistency that this young man has, I mean, he's in his second year, for crying out loud.
Right.
Rookie of the year last year. How can you have that composure and that stuff? I guess as Jim Fry used to say about Dwight Gooden, he'd say Jim Fry was the manager of the Cubs at the time, and he'd say everybody was saying, well, what poise Doc Gooden had. And Jim Fry said, if you throw the ball 99 miles an hour and have a curveball that breaks off the table, you'd be poised too.
Yeah, that's a bet. But by the way, who would know that better than you, Tim McCarver, being you caught the great Bob Gibson for so many years? And he tended to throw the ball a little hard, yes?
Well, it's interesting that you talk about Bob, because then this is not a plug for Bob's book, but I guess it turns out that way. But Bob's got a new book out called Pitch by Pitch.
Oh.
And it's about game one of the 1968 World Series, 47 years ago. And he struck out 17, the most in a game by any pitcher in the history of the game. And you think about that, Sid, no other pitcher today will probably have an opportunity to strike out 17 pitchers, because they're on a pitch count, and they rarely go more than seven innings.
Yeah. No, I know. Those days, Marichal would go 12, 13, 14. Spahn would go 15, 16. Gibson would pitch a bunch of times. Fair to say, Tim, that in all the years you've watched, we'll get back to the Met Royal Series in a second, but all the years you've watched and played, caught guys like Gibson and Carlton, many other greats, that the biggest big-game performer you've ever seen and or played with, Bob Gibson?
Yes. Yeah, I mean, you know, there are other pitchers who perhaps were suited to do that, but they never had the opportunity to do that. Bob had both the opportunity and the result. He started three games in the 1964 World Series, three in 67, three in 68. Eight of the nine were complete games. In the game that he lost, he went eight innings and struck out 12.
Wow.
That was his first game against the Yankees.
Jesus.
So, I mean, this guy, he turns 80 years old, by the way, in November.
Oh, my God. Look at that. God bless him.
Yeah.
You know, I think.
But the Mets pitching is very, very serious stuff from these starters. And DeGrom is one of the best around. I mean, this guy is he's special. I mean, real special.
Smoltz, John Smoltz, who all he did was go to the Hall of Fame with two other starters in Atlanta, Tom Glavine and Greg Maddux, says that these four Mets starters may be the best ever. He actually said better than our guys. Of course, they pitched longer. They made the Hall of Fame. Mets aren't there yet. He was talking about just potential and talent. And that's why I'm going to say this, Tim. If the Mets lose this World Series, Met fans like myself will say we lost the World Series because we got the great pitching. But is that bad of the Royals, who ran away with the American League, that back in the World Series for the second straight year? Would that be disrespectful to Kansas City?
I don't know whether it would be disrespectful, but I think one of the reasons that the Royals are a slight favorite to win this World Series, regardless of how many games it goes, their middle defense, the ability to turn the double play, and their middle relief. Those two elements are stronger than the Mets. As a matter of fact, they're much stronger than the Mets. However, on the other hand, the performance by John Neese last night, I think, turns that around a bit. I think Neese was terrific in his filling in for the Mets in a very, very important position last night. So, I mean, you really don't know. I don't know whether it would be any disrespect on the part of the Royals, but I do believe the Royals will win the World Series.
You do?
I mean, I do.
Mm.
Yes.
Awesome.
And not because they won last night or anything like that, but there's a reason why they were slight favorites. And last night, an example of that, I mean, their defense was just superb.
Yeah.
You think about Moustakas at third base, not known for his defense. He knocks one ball down to save a run, and then he makes a great play on the next batter to save a run. So and Escobar is all over the place in the middle infield, and they have good throwers in the outfield. They have four Gold Glovers defensively, and that's very, very important when a wild throw or something like that could be the difference in a ball game.
Well, break it down for me, Tim. You're still involved doing games for the St. Louis Cardinals, who had a very disappointing exit. Although I wasn't surprised, I actually picked the Cubs and the Pirates. Whatever team won that wild card game, I thought was going to beat your Cardinals, and they did. But with that said,
me too. I thought that too.
Yeah. So we know in New York, when the Mets are winning, I believe the Met fan base is more energetic, more alive, because it rarely happens, than the Yankees. Yankees almost expect it. But it's a Yankee town. In the state of Missouri, how do the Royals match up against St. Louis? How wild is the state when the Royals are in the World Series?
Along the cable networks this year, the Kansas City Royals, in the country, that is, of all cable games that were presented, the Royals had the greatest rating.
Wow.
Of any team, and the Cardinals were number two.
Wow.
Far and away better than any other cable network. Now, you think about that. The Royals were number one, and the Cardinals were number two in ratings.
That's unbelievable. That's unbelievable.
I know it's pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, Missouri, they love their baseball, no question. So the state's excited about it. They are the slim favorite. They've already won game one. It's an exciting series. We know that. I believe it's going to be a very, very lengthy series. If the Mets, though, aren't back going to buck your trend and win this series, it'll be because of what? Because, listen, Dan Murphy, that ain't going to happen again. We know that. So,
Murphy with two great at bats last night, a couple of singles, actually walked another time. This guy is really on fire. And I think Pete Rose in the pregame on Fox Sports 1, had it right. He said, don't expect a home run from Murphy tonight, but he's locked in as far as hitting is concerned, and he proved that. But tonight's game is going to depend on how deep in the game DeGrom can go. I mean, you've got a weakened bullpen, weakened because of innings last night. If DeGrom can go eight instead of seven, I did a Cardinal game this year where DeGrom pitched. He threw five pitches in the eighth inning, shutting out the Cardinals, and Terry Collins took him out after the eighth inning.
I remember that.
That's the nature of the game now.
Yep.
I mean, but eight innings is a lot greater. I mean, a lot greater, even though it's only three outs. It's a lot greater than going seven innings because you can make the bridge immediately to your closer. And that's what the Mets need to do tonight to win, in my opinion.
Okay. And in the end here, Tim, last one, another 20 minutes of great stuff. I love you. You know that. You're great. Give me this. This is going to be a lengthy. I know you're picking the Royals, but it'll be lengthy. It'll be exciting, memorable. When we talk again in 2 weeks, we're going to say what about this World Series?
Well, it's hard to say, but I mean, if the games are anything like that were like last night's
right.
game,
right.
You're going to have a lot to talk about over the winter. Believe me, it's wonderful. It's wonderful. A lot of people can't stand low scoring ball games, but when you see these pitchers work, and this guy tonight, the best of the lot of the two teams, one of the best in the game with DeGrom, you see why people love the game and love to analyze the game and love to talk about the game. It's just wonderful.
Timmy, you're wonderful. Thank you. This was great. Every time you come on, it's a big honor, and I appreciate it, and this was great. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
You're more than welcome, Sid.
Nice to talk to you. The great Tim McCarver. And, of course, out there in the state of Missouri does the Cardinals stuff. And how about that statistic Timmy just gave us? Royals number one, Cardinals number two, and not a close third. I thought that was very interesting. All right, that was a nice little run there, right? We went from Ron and Sana, CNBC, breaking down tonight's GOP debate. They've got it tonight on CNBC. To Jim Nance, to Tim McCarver. Now, the phones are wide open the final 30 minutes. 844-640-6464. 844-640-6464. We'll come back with more nonsense right after this.
Welcome back to the Sid Rosenberg Show.
What a dick.
What
do
you
mean? What do you do now? What happened
now? He knows we're both not in good moods. He goes, why? You're not in a good mood?
Well, you particularly are in a really it's actually silly. I mean, it's one game. It's not, we were down 3-0. I would react the way you are today. Right. People lose World Series games.
Yeah, but it was
sweep.
We won the game.
It's fine. We didn't win the game. We move on. The whole idea is you split the first two games. You very rarely go on the road and win the first two anyway. Did the Mets blow an opportunity last night? Yes. But if your best pitcher wins tonight, you go back to Queens 1-1 on Friday, you're in great shape. You're acting this morning like we're down 3-0. I mean, God, you got to calm down.
I had confidence going into the 10th when we had runners. We had someone on third with one out and Michael Kadire, the worst player in baseball history. This guy is... Why is he even on the roster?
He won a batting title a couple of years ago.
Get him off the roster.
But he's the worst player in the history of Major League Baseball?
Where was Juan Uribe?
Is he hurt?
He's on the roster. I don't want to see Michael Kadire even in the dugout. Leave him in the clubhouse. He is so bad. He was swinging when the ball would be in the pitcher's mitt. He would swing after.
I saw that, yes. It was very, very unfortunate and bad. I agree with you.
He would swing after the ball.
He was a little behind the fastball. I did see that, yeah. I did. But the guy that's really bothering me is Cespedes. The guy cannot get a big hit. He can't.
Every time he goes up, he's hacking for the fences. Can you just get a base hit?
Just hit the ball. Yeah.
There was a point up there. We had runners on one of the corners or first and second.
Like Michael Kadire.
Get a base hit.
It's Sid Rosenberg on 640 Sports.
I can almost see it. That dream I'm dreaming, but there's a voice inside my head saying, you'll never reach it. Every step I'm taking, every move I make feels lost with no direction. My faith is shaken, but I gotta keep trying, gotta keep.
Great song, and two very masculine men, mind you, who lift a lot of weight. Me and Langell love this old Miley Cyrus song.
It's a great song.
It is a great song.
Could be her best.
She's been lousy since, and this is when she was still like long haired and young and cute, and then she went nuts.
Yeah, she did.
Cut her hair, does that twerking stuff, that stupid tongue thing she does.
Who knew that Hannah Montana had that in her?
Right. But this is when she was really, really good, and I used to like this song because, see, I've changed in my life now. There was a time when the climb, she talks about how sometimes the climb is great, you know. Sometimes, you know, the grass is not always greener. When you get there, you find out it's not always greener. And I kind of believed that for a long time. I enjoyed early in my career. When I look back now, Nance talks about that with me, you know, watching your career, Sid, and you know, looking back at a little struggle, syndicated radio with Scott Kaplan. It led to that morning show with WNEW, the legendary New York rock station. And then I got to WFAN, and I started out by doing just a couple of, you know, hits on I Miss Every Single Week and filling in for Beningo overnights. And eventually from there, not long after, I was the midday show host, which was a big, big deal. I got the Giants, and that was a climb. There was a progression, a very noticeable climb in my career. And then it took a nosedive like a...
Well, that was the fall.
Yeah, and now the climb has just become so exhausting and so tiring that I'm completely disheartened. In fact, I got a text from Bernard McGurk yesterday. We're talking about doing more shows together. We did two shows this summer at another legendary station. I'm one of the few guys, maybe the only guy, that can boast working at 1010 Wins, WABC, and WFAN. We had two great shows this summer, filling in for Geraldo. Great. And his boss, Craig Schwab, loved it. And I received lauding and superlatives and all that stuff. And Bernard wants to do it again, and so do I. And I keep getting told, yeah, we're going to do it again. And okay. When is that? You know, again, this is not a... sometimes I do this, and the last thing I would ever want is Leo or Beth or the folks here to think I'm not happy here because, well, I'm not very happy here, to be honest, but it's fine. What are you laughing at?
Oh, just...
And then I just received some horrible news.
You've just received horrible news?
This is horrible
news. This is great news.
Be quiet. Let me explain it first.
Illness in the family or something?
No. This is worse.
Worse?
This is worse.
Oh.
Worse.
Good God.
This is just... And then you can explain your piece after, okay? Part of the reason why this show is great is Ricky Balufe.
What?
I don't know. He's just standing there, and he's just so happy I said that. I was actually going to say that kid Garrett, but he's going to be good for us, this kid Garrett. He's a hard worker. He's a nice kid. He's got the IQ of a box of nails, but he's... I told him three times just now, come back at 9:45. He looked at me like I was speaking Latin, and he continued to stand by the microphone.
And he goes, hey, is this your headset? Can I use it? I said, yeah, 9:45. He's like, what?
Oh. Idiot. Anyway.
Nah, so he's a nice kid.
Here's the news. Part of the reason why this show is great, seriously, is you two guys. You guys are great. And I'm not going to lie. I get a certain amount of joy. Like Friday, for example, when me, Danielle, Ava, and Gabe went to New York, New Jersey, for the wedding, and I put the show on Friday morning, and even though you guys were awful, I mean just awful, you were great.
Thank you.
You were great because you were doing your thing. You know, Z-Mac was talking a mile a minute about the trees in Mexico, and, you know, you were fumbling and stumbling, and it was just, you know, Balufe actually added some smarts to the broadcast, believe it or not, but you guys were great, and it's us. That's what we are. None of us are, you know, we're just... regular guys, man. That's our show. We're regular guys. And I think you guys are really good on the air because I think, you know, you speak from that place. And I would love to see you guys do a show every day. We've been over that. Like the wrap-up show after us, like Gary Delabate does. Or at the very least, have a weekend show, do something. I think you guys have earned it. And quite frankly, I think you guys are good enough. I really do. I mean that sincerely. So I find out today that Z-Mac, my son Z-Mac, I have two sons, you know, I have Gable and Z-Mac. My son Z-Mac... is going to get a show.
Wow, that's great.
My initial reaction was, just say it again.
That's great.
That was my initial reaction.
It was.
Great.
Yep, I can attest to it.
I'm like, great! And then came this. Do you know Eric Lange? Well, let's start with this. What is a very popular game played all across the country, $1 billion business? And by the way, right now there is a huge FBI case going on that's going to shut down the two top players. Remember, I used to do those live reads on this show. Uh-oh, not anymore. What game would I be talking about?
Cornhole. No.
Is that a very popular sport?
That's cornhole. Very popular now, cornhole. I don't know, but Anyways, no, that would have to be fantasy football.
Fantasy football.
Yes.
Do you know, and this is why we're the best station in town, we're the only station that doesn't have a fantasy football show.
I have heard that, yes.
Okay. Have you ever heard these other guys do the local fantasy football
show? I have caught them.
Mark Eisenberg, he's got Jamie Eisenberg on, Orlando, all those guys. Okay. I would rather do a Bukkake video with a bunch of Iraqi soldiers than listen to 5 minutes. 5 minutes of a fantasy. I would. I mean, put me in Fallujah and give me a thousand guys. Bukkake. Then 5 minutes of fantasy football. So our son here, Z-Mac, has a show, but it's a fantasy football show.
Well, that was
Here's a kid that has these incredible, passionate, whether it's Michael Kadire, Benjamin Netanyahu, Roger Waters. We've heard some of the best, and I'll include Stern, I don't care, and Imus, I work with both. We've heard some of the best on-air rants ever in the history of this medium over the last 3 years, and they're going to have this kid talk about how many yards Adrian Peterson is going to get against the freaking 49ers.
Well, there's a need for the fantasy for the show. There's a calling for it. There's a demand.
That's what I was told.
See, after the show, Z-Mac was extremely confident and pumped. He looked at me and goes, I'm going in to talk to Leo right now.
You got to turn it down.
No, what do you mean? It could parlay into something and else.
You have to turn it down. This will. Remember how angry I was with Lengel when he stabbed me in the back all those times and take 50 bucks from
never,
Big O?
Never.
Like 10 times.
Never.
Very upset with
what? Listen, it's not going to be like Big O. I'll even bring you on to even break down a segment.
Oh.
How many yards did Shane Vereen have? How many catches? You get a half a point for each catch.
Who to start? Who to sit?
You have to turn it down. If you have any what's what I'm looking for here, Lengel? Let's see.
Integrity?
Thank you. If you have any integrity, you will say, thank you for the opportunity, but no. Now, if he says, during your one-hour extravaganza, it couldn't hurt to throw in a quick 3 or 4 minute report and but you're allowed to still talk about Israel. You're allowed to talk about the Mets.
No, he's already been told that. No, it's all about fantasy.
So you cannot.
There is no.
Maybe football. Maybe like game lines or
maybe a breaking football story that morning
right,
or something.
But it's a football show Sunday.
Fantasy.
Right. From 11 to 12.
See,
1 hour.
Z-Mac had great intentions. He thought that he and I would have a Saturday morning show or a find a slot.
But that's what I want.
And then he came out and said, I got a fantasy show on Sunday.
Oh, so you stabbed him in the back, too.
No, I walked in. I talked to Leo. No. Leo said, we're the only station that doesn't have a fantasy football show.
In all fairness.
You actually told him that?
No. Leo, I went into Leo. I said, hey, listen, I'd like to do a weekend show.
Right. You didn't say I want to do a fantasy show.
No. And he said, we're the only station that doesn't have a fantasy football show. How does Sunday from 11 to 12 sound? And I said, I'm in.
And see, he did offer me a part of it, but I don't know anything about fantasy.
Now,
in my defense, I've played fantasy a lot, and Eisenberg told me last year if I won his league again, he would never let me in again. So I came in second, and I did not win. Uh-huh. But I do pretty well. Uh-huh. So that's maybe great. I can build a fan base or something. I don't know.
Oh, yeah, it'll be huge.
And then go to NFL Network and sit with...
Jamie Dukes. Matt Miskirzian and...
It's a $1 billion business, you know.
I understand that. So is heroin. You going to start dealing today? So is Asian porn. You going to make a movie today? You got to... This is fantasy football. You're going to be... Oh, forget it. If you want to do it, go ahead. I mean, are they going to pay you for this? No. I'm sure not. No, be honest.
They're working on trying to get it sponsored.
They can't sponsor this epping show. I got the same 6 accounts for 6 months. Turn it down. If you have any pride, I mean any, unless this is what you are. You're on your stomach.
No.
Your butt is about 4 inches off the bed.
Stop it.
Where would you like Leo Baldwin to orgasm when he's finished? Leave it there or turn you around and put it right between the eyes?
Oh, jeez. Stop. Look. Everyone has a starting place, right?
Right. He's past
CBS
that.
Sports Line for you.
Right.
fantasy football show for Z-Mag. Next stop, the fan.
No, I wouldn't go that far, but... And Ricky, you'll be...
I only wish I knew. I could brush up on my right. fantasy.
So you do. So you do.
I'm hearing him now saying that he went in the office and said that he wanted his weekend show. I didn't hear him say Eric
no,
and
no,
I.
He, so. No, listen, listen.
I think I have been stabbed in the back.
No, 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 no. The first response to Eric goes, you're going to drive one hour...
Let me make this clear, and then we'll take phone calls, which is on the line. We'll take more. 844-640-6464. He views you. I don't care what he says.
Oh.
You're an albatross. You're an albatross. You know when somebody's drowning?
Yes.
And they grab you because they don't want to drown?
Right.
So they survive, the other guy drowns?
Hmm.
That's this.
Yeah. I could see that.